We have somebody who knows about religious authority and that kind of societies, yes, yet you have made the choice for Tunisia to be a pluralistic society, so that the religious authority steps away to create a society which is, quote-unquote, more free. If so, why? Why is it that you have made that choice and not the choice of Alexander to have an authoritarian society?
We are in Tunisia in transition, but we know where.
Ah. Bravo. With on.
Yes. So we are going to rebuild a real society based on freedom, on democracy, reconcile between the concept of an individualism and the concept of society,
community.
How reconcile we? Because Islam respect both individual and the collective, the community. So we are going to establish advanced society, developed economy, and reconcile between through the concept of consensus between all fractions, all ideologies, all parties. So far, we succeed to provoke or to the peaceful revolution, and after that we preserve this flame of liberty, of revolution, we preserve and transform it into into institution, constitution based on human rights, on the equality between sex. It's different from what happened in Egypt, where there is a coup d'etat, real coup d'etat, and we can criticize Brotherhood, and I have done, I criticize them, but we cannot pretend that we are Democrat and defend the coup d'etat happened. So it's scandal.
No, but
scandal, Western democracy is sort of scandal to defend this coup d'etat, this system of eradicate totally any voice of the of liberty, of democracy. So we hope that Western democracies invest in democracy in Arab world, not invest in dictatorship.
I must say, on moral grounds,
yes.
On moral grounds, I prefer your Islamism to his Eurasianism. I just want to be clear.
And look, we are experiencing in liberal democracies a tremendous moment of challenge, and for the reasons that Leon and others
problems.
Have said earlier, problems. And we do have to get back to first principles. But there are still certain first principles that really do matter and resonate. One is that if you don't have a system in which the leaders are actually responsive and accountable to the people, at some point you're headed for failure. If you don't have a system in which the people and the mechanisms through which they're represented have the ability to tell the leader that he has no clothes, at some point he or she is going to make a fatal mistake. And so, for example, Hitler was a pretty terrible general, but his own generals couldn't tell him that. And that led to something you're familiar with, Stalingrad. If the emperor has no clothes, but no one can tell him, this is how nations fail. But there's something else at play here. And I think, again, I, with great respect, suggest that this collective nationalist notion of strength and power is the wrong one. If we were sitting around this table 50 years ago or 100 years ago when we were asking ourselves this question, what constitutes the wealth of a nation? Probably we'd all offer different versions of the same answer. Well, it's the abundance of its natural resources. It's the strength of its army. It's the size of its population. It's the expanse of its geography. And those things still matter. And as it happens, Russia is still well endowed with them, so is the United States. But I think what we recognize more and more in the 21st century is that the true wealth of a nation is its human resources and the ability of a country to allow them to reach their full potential. And so the great question for all of us is, what are the best means to do that? How do you achieve that? How do you allow the human resource to become educated? How do you allow it to be protected? How do you allow it to debate, to argue, to fight, to create. And for all of the deficiencies of liberal democracy, I still believe profoundly that no other system gives us the same opportunities to do that.
Yeah, but then Cody, the question is, listen, you have all these things, and yet Mr. Trump was elected.
Yes.
How come? Listen, why is it that those things you just mentioned in a very eloquent way are not in place right now in the United States of America?
Well, first of all, they are.
And it's not only because
they are in place. They are in place.
But it's not functioning.
Well, in fact, in many ways, it still is functioning. First of all, we can never mind the fact that 3 million more people voted for his opponent.
Yeah, it doesn't work.
We have some structural problems in the system from its origins. But beyond that, no, it is working. And the fact of the matter is also this. One of the things that I find profoundly hard to rationalize, I mean, of course I understand it, but we're going through a huge crisis and fight over immigration in our country. The idea that we would somehow profoundly object to the fact that the United States is the one country on earth that more people still want to come to get educated, to do business, to visit, that that's a problem, not a great source of strength, is one of the great puzzles of this moment. But the fact is, that's still true. And the fact is, if you go around the world, as I had the opportunity to do as a diplomat, many of our policies were often rightly debated, disagreed with. But the one thing that remained across the board, a very powerful pole of attraction for us, was precisely our education, our science, our technology, our entrepreneurship, our innovation.
That
all functions very powerfully.
Do you think that the education system in America, in North America, in the West, is actually achieving what it should be? I only say that because the education so much nowadays, especially with the advancement of technology, has been equated with a degree and a diploma in order to get a job, in order to be part of a manufactured system. I usually use a term in Farsi. In Persian, we have a different word for people who are in university and those who are in high school, for example. The first one means is a student, a learning. The second means a seeker of knowledge. Mm-hmm. And I grew up in a world where the idea of going to university was always the notion that you'll go to get knowledge and you seek knowledge. And my experience of universities, colleges around, especially in the Western world, despite all the wonderful freedom that exists, is that there's a degree of mediocrity. There is a degree of dumbing down, and I go back to that. The only thing I would agree with him on this is the question of what is threatening freedom as well is the political correctness, mm-hmm. is the kind of a fear of not wanting to say, so the void has been felt by the populace, by those who were bluntly racist and fascist, and yet they can get to say what they want to say. But the rest of us, because of our liberalism, because of our politeness, because of that notion of sort of we want to be civilized, we are no longer able to. The use of language, for example, in North America. I am working on a documentary about media in the Middle East and the Western media, and I can tell you that the use of language to avoid to tell the truth about the Middle East, for example, is so creative that it could be passed as fiction. And I think those are the roots of problem for me. I would love to see liberalism and democracy flourish all over the world, since I am one of the people who have directly benefited from it. But at the same time, I like to acknowledge that there are some fundamental problems, and I think education is one of the first places where I would go to, because I'm a big advocate of education for all the people, including in the Middle East and Afghanistan and in the West. And the second thing for me, which again, I fought against communism. I flourished in a sort of a socialist system in Canada, but I find more and more that there is a big problem with the market society. I don't have a problem with market economy because there is a morality attached to it, there are some values attached to it, and it's about competition and about achieving the best. But when a society has become a market society, like as we're experiencing, and I thought China is one of the greatest examples of it, then that kind of a mediocre educational system, the political correctness, and the market economy where everything is for sale, including love and friendship and everything else, has become devoid of the kind of moral values that we held so dear as freedom and that individual freedom that I respect and I will die for. Yeah, that would be the only thing.
It's several issues at once. And they're serious issues. One, I mean, the dumbing down of education. It's probably unavoidable because it has to do with it's becoming a mass phenomenon. I mean,
in the old days, I mean, there was a very narrow group of people who received college and higher education. It's the same like with music. I mean, music used to be an elite phenomenon, and there was some great music then. You know, today it's a phenomenon of mass culture, and most of it is rubbish. And you know, we all know
people from Prague think that once upon a time only Mozart existed,
or the Velvet
Underground. Not quite, but almost, Leon. But the second thing, which is probably more serious and very troubling, is what is being taught in the universities. And in the first panel, I think it was Bertrand Lévy who spoke about, mentioned Michel Foucault, and for me, this is, it's not the Foucault's blame or anything, but this is where the process of postmodernism, deconstruction of truth and its dissipation into what we call narratives. I have a narrative, you have a narrative, my narrative is as good as your narrative. And that's all true. People have different narratives, but the very concept of truth has evaporated. There is no truth. I mean, a friend of mine, Peter Pomerantsev, a Russian, wrote a quite wonderful book about Russia, which is where nothing is true and everything is possible. And that is increasingly the world we're living in. And we have to make an effort to persuade people who are still willing to listen to us that the quest for truth may be very complex and sometimes unsuccessful and also quite painful because...
I think you're right. I would say two things.
But we have to get there.
I would say two things about that. The first is that the political crisis that we're facing in the United States is at bottom, if you pardon the expression, an epistemological crisis, in that it's not that we disagree about policies, we no longer agree on a description of reality. And that is a very, very profound problem, a very profound problem. The second thing that's worth saying is when you talk about education and the media, it's very important to remember that an open society places an enormous intellectual responsibility on ordinary people. That is to say, in an open society, we govern ourselves by means of our opinions. We count them in elections, we discuss them. This means that the quality of our opinions will determine the quality of our politics. And this means that what will really determine the quality of our politics is the quality of our opinion formation. And education and media in an open society are those are the machineries of opinion formation. And one of the things you're seeing, and certainly in the United States right now, is a complete breakdown and degeneration of opinion formation. And that is a problem that, frankly, it's not a political problem, it's a cultural problem. Culture is much harder to deal with than politics. For that reason, it's going to take a while. This is not a question of an election cycle. It's a much larger problem. And frankly, I'm not sure what we're going to do about it. But I think the crisis is that deep.